Well, we'll begin the Q&A in just a moment. First off, just a little bit about us for those who aren't as familiar. FSI is Stanford's hub for nonpartisan interdisciplinary research, teaching, and policy impact in international affairs. Our mission is to produce world-class scholarship, prepare future leaders, and influence policymaking in pursuit of solutions to the most critical global issues. And today's Q&A is with our director, Michael McFaul, who will focus on the evolving Ukraine-Russia confrontation.
Let me say two words of welcome. I know lots of you have tried to reach out to me and ping me about interviews, and we're desperately behind. So we're trying to reach out to as many people as we can. And if we don't get to certain questions, please keep pinging me and we'll do the best we can to get to them. But for now, I want to remind everybody we're on the record. So usually we have to say we're off the record. We are on the record today. And let's play Ask Me Anything.
Great. So first up, we have Viviana Maza. Yeah.
Go ahead.
Hi. Thank you for this opportunity. I work for Corriere della Sera, a newspaper in Italy. My question is, do you see in the current situation in Ukraine the possibility of the comprehensive grand bargain for enhancing European security, the Helsinki 2.0 that you wrote about in Foreign Affairs?
Well, thanks for asking that question. And for those of you who didn't see it, I published a piece in Foreign Affairs on Friday, outlining in a lot of detail, just so it's, I really get into the weeds. The premise of the argument is on many points, my view is that Mr. Putin does not have any legitimate claims. I think the way he's also trying to pursue those claims through the use of threatening military force and God forbid, maybe military force is also of course illegitimate. And some of his ideas in the treaties that they sent to Washington and to NATO. And by the way, let's just remember that usually treaties are published when they're negotiated at the end. They're kept secret up to that point. I've negotiated with the Russians on some treaties, including the New START treaty. And that's a very unusual tactic to publish unilaterally what you want and then just ask everybody else to sign at the bottom. And some of the things that he asked for in there are completely non-starters. The most important one being telling NATO to close its door to aspirants, first and foremost, Ukraine, and telling NATO to move back to its 1997 borders in terms of deployments. That's a non-starter. But if Putin genuinely wanted to talk about European security issues in ways that could be good for Russia, good for Ukraine, good for Italy, Viviana, good for the continent, good for the United States and other OSCE members. My view, as I outlined in that piece, is that there's actually a lot of work to be done, that a lot of the old treaties are not working the way we wanted to. We've pulled out of some, like the INF treaty. Russia's stopped enforcing its part of the deal for the CFE treaty. Open skies is no longer working. Vienna documents aren't really working. And so I outlined in the piece that I wrote, you know, going through all of that, both transparency, arms control, individual rights, where if Putin wanted to negotiate, I think there's actually a substantive agenda to be had. And I invoke Helsinki, referencing Helsinki Final Act from 1975, to remind readers, especially younger readers, that you know, in 1975, it wasn't exactly like we were in a close partnership with the communist Soviet Union. We were in a Cold War with them. We were, you know, battling their regimes all over the world. Marxist-Leninist regimes had just taken over in parts of Southeast Asia. They were coming to power in Southern Africa. It was still a very confrontational time in U.S.-Soviet relations and the Soviets' relationship with Europe. And yet, even within that context, we managed to sign an agreement that I think made all parties better off. And that's what I think we should aspire to. But you asked me a different question, which I haven't answered, is do I think Putin will sign up to it? My answer to that is I don't know. I'm not that optimistic, frankly. The last news cycle here in the United States saw a lot of people saying, oh, maybe we've dodged a bullet. And Foreign Minister Lavrov said some things about diplomacy that were encouraging. And I take note of that. They were encouraging. But I also take note of some discouraging things when President Putin, for instance, talked about alleged genocide in Donbass. If there's genocide against Russians next to the Russian border, that sounds like he's thinking of stopping that genocide. After all, remember his excuse for annexing Crimea in 2014 was to protect Russians. Now, completely concocted, just like he just did right now. There's no genocide in Donbass, but I'm just reminding you of the parallel kinds of arguments from 2014 today. And then second, the parliament in Russia, the Duma, which is very loyal to President Putin, recently just passed a resolution, albeit non-binding, but a resolution calling for the recognition of the two republics in Donbass. They're called republics by the so-called separatists there, Donetsk and Luhansk, People's Republics, to recognize those as independent states. Well, that reminds me of Georgia 2008, when Russia intervened militarily and then recognized two regions of Georgia, Abkhazia and South Ossetia, as independent states. So that doesn't make me very optimistic that Putin wants to sit down and negotiate, but I think it's until military action occurs, I think it's right for President Biden and all European leaders, and even Bolsonaro, he's there today. I just saw a meeting with President Putin, should try to engage with him to seek a negotiated path as opposed to a military path.
If I may, there was specifically one point that Biden offered, something like a deal on the intermediate range missiles, not the non-nuclear ones, that it's possible to actually deploy in Europe. And initially, if I'm not mistaken, the answer from the Kremlin was, this is a secondary issue. First, we want to talk about Ukraine's, possibility of entering NATO. But I was wondering if this discussion about missiles in Europe could be actually a starting point or a good point for an agreement.
Yeah, I'm glad you raised that. And because President Biden yesterday made some news, I thought, in the way that he described this. He said a couple of things. One, along the lines that you're talking about. Two, he made crystal clear that the United States has no intentions of deploying missiles that can attack Russia in Ukraine. The Javelins, just to be clear, that the anti-tank missiles that the United States has been sending to Ukraine, those are very short-term tactical weapons. They are not ones that can reach cities in Russia. And that has been one of the talking points. You know, the three has been, no membership in NATO for Ukraine, back to the 1997 borders for NATO. And then this third one about no deployments of rockets in Ukraine. And I've talked to Biden administration officials about this. They're rather perplexed by what they're talking about there. It's not very clear. But on that issue, I think there could be ready agreement, as long as, of course, it would be done in a reciprocal basis. So just as Putin doesn't want American rockets in Ukraine that can reach Moscow. We don't want rockets in Kaliningrad, they're called Iskanders, that can reach NATO capitals. And so arms control always has to be reciprocal. It just can't be one-way street. The other thing I want to say, though, that you mentioned that I think is important, because the Russian government and Lavrov always keep saying, we have primary and secondary concerns. I would call those maximalist and more moderate demands. And I would just remind people, I don't pretend I know what the future will be, of course, regarding negotiations, but I have negotiated with the Russians. Let's just focus on the New START Treaty for a minute. But we could also talk about WTO accession, which is a very complicated negotiation with Russia back when I worked for the Obama administration. Back to remind everybody, I worked 3 years at the White House at the National Security Council, 2009 to 2012, and then 2 years as the ambassador for the United States, 2012 to 2014. And in the New START negotiations, at the very beginning, one of the maximalist demands from the Russian government was, in this new treaty, there must be constraints on missile defenses. Must be categorically top issue. If we don't get this in the treaty, there will be no treaty. And one of my first missions as a White House official was to fly to meet with my Russian counterparts. I can't remember now. I think it was Brussels, but maybe it was somewhere else. Now I'm forgetting. I'm getting old. But we delivered a two-page statement to them saying, these are the things we're prepared to talk about, but we're not prepared to have missile defense constraints in that treaty. And for the next several months, until the very last days of the negotiations, this was a sticking point in the negotiations that we eventually resolved, as I describe in the foreign affairs piece, by what are called side letters, where each side unilaterally publishes non-binding side letters stating their position, but it's not part of the treaty. And again, maybe I'm being too optimistic here, but I'm pretty confident in predicting that Putin knows that a moratorium on NATO expansion to Ukraine is simply not possible for President Biden to agree to. Remember, we have our own politics here in the United States, and that is just, in addition to being bad policy, in my view, I think it would be bad politics for President Biden. And I think Putin understands that, by the way. By the way, Putin also understands that you know, NATO, an offer of NATO membership to Ukraine has not really been on the table since 2008. It was most certainly not an issue of discussion for the entire 5 years that I worked in the government. I think Putin understands that too. So maybe there's a way to agree to disagree about that issue in the context of a larger negotiation. And that's kind of, you know, my hopeful proposal that I outlined in that foreign affairs piece.
Our next question will be from Bob Rowley.
Thank you for taking questions from the media, Ambassador. And I know you've had and answered these questions in different ways, but do you see any or put any credibility in some of the criticism that the U.S. has helped cause this crisis sort of by our behavior in the long run? These stories and criticisms that promises were made by Presidents Bush and Clinton, Secretary of State Jim Baker, and others that after the fall of the Soviet Union at the end of the Cold War, we wouldn't move NATO farther east, closer to Russia after the fall, and that we went back on these promises, that they were given verbally and in writing in various ways over time, and that, you know, Putin is still at it 30 years later, coming back at us on these things. Do you put any credibility in those criticisms at all?
Well, Bob, that's a big, hard, complicated question. And Ari, I think maybe you should arrange another call like this with our colleague, Jim Goldgeier, who's visiting, who's written a book on NATO expansion. He's at American University, but he's here at FSI this semester to go through the history. I think actually it would be quite interesting. But let me give you an answer. On the going all the way back to 30 years, was there some informal quiet agreement between Jim Baker and Mikhail Gorbachev that was reneged on? I think the evidence is on that is pretty clear, and that there was none. Gorbachev himself has said that. Mikhail Sergeyevich has said that. Number two, I'm not a professional diplomat, but I worked as a diplomat for a while, and I've written about diplomats for most of my life. There's no such thing as an informal quiet agreement that's not written down. That's not real. That's not a credible, you know, and let me tell you, the Russians are emphatic about writing everything down. That has been my experience in negotiating with them. So even if there was some loose conversation, if it's not in the treaty, it doesn't exist. And by the way, we experienced some of this in the New START treaty, when I was part of that team, when, you know, there was a casual, you know, informal conversation between some of the Russian negotiators and Americans, and they interpreted that to be that we had agreed to limits on missile defense. And we had to, you know, President Obama had to get on the phone and tell President Medvedev that we're not agreeing. And until it's written down and we all sign off on it, you know, there's nothing is agreed until everything's agreed. So that's on the old history. A couple other things I think are important to say. Over the period of 30 years, NATO expansion has not been a popular idea for any Soviet or Russian president. That's true. The book that I wrote, actually 2003, I think it is, with Professor Goldgar, we wrote about the history of US-Russian and US-Soviet relations after the collapse. And we have a chapter in there, it's chapter 8, and the title of it is NATO, a four-letter word. And I just, I'm just saying that because of course it has been a contested issue for a long time. But we need to remind ourselves, why is it that those countries want to join NATO? It's because they were annexed by the Soviet Union or the Russian Empire, or they were subjugated by puppet regimes of the Communist Party of the Soviet Union. So yes, it's important to think about Russian concerns, but we can't just think about their concerns and not think about Estonian concerns or Polish concerns, given, you know, the very tragic history that those countries lived under. So we need to manage that, but just because Moscow disagrees doesn't mean that that should be our policy. But third, and maybe most importantly, in my reading of this history, and I've written about it quite a bit, and I'll post some things for deeper dives. The concern with NATO expansion goes up and down in US-Russian relations, depending on where the relationship is more generally. It's not the driver of conflict, it's the reflection of conflict. And the central driver in recent years, since Vladimir Putin has been president, in my view, has not been the debate about NATO expansion. The last major wave of NATO expansion was announced in 2002, after all, 20 years ago. The major driver, in my view, is what Putin would call color revolutions. Georgia 2003, Ukraine 2004, when I was in the government, the Arab Spring in 2011, then massive demonstrations in Russia itself at the end of 2011, 2012, and one more time in Ukraine in 2013, 2014. What he calls a coup d'etat, what Ukrainians call the Maidan, the revolution of dignity. And what happened in each of those cases was there was a mass mobilization against an autocratic regime. And Putin thought that we were behind those. And so every time that happens, that's when the conflict raises. And then that's when the NATO expansion flag gets raised again. So when I was in the government, tragically, Russia had invaded Georgia, occupied forces there. And so there was no debate about NATO expansion towards Georgia because NATO was not going to accept a country into its alliance that was occupied with Russian forces. That's a tragic fact. Whether it's right or wrong, it's a tragic fact. And everybody knew it in Georgia. And then he invaded Ukraine in 2014, doing exactly the same thing, which meant that de facto, there was no serious debate about NATO expansion to Ukraine as long as those Russian soldiers are there. So I think the real driver is this other thing, his reaction to democratic movements. And then when that happens, that's when the NATO card, the NATO and Nazis, as I said, in 2014, take over. With our current crisis, let's just be clear, there was no new decision in Brussels about Ukrainian NATO membership. They haven't even signed a membership action plan. That's the first step towards joining NATO. Unless that's a secret document that I haven't seen, I have no knowledge that President Biden made some new decision to speed up the process of Ukraine joining NATO. And when I hosted President Zelensky here at Stanford last August and talked to him about this, my impression, he had just seen President Biden the day before, my impression was, yes, NATO aspirations is something that all Ukrainians, not all, but some aspire to. It's written in their constitution after all. But there was no change, sudden change. What changed was that Putin moved 150,000 soldiers to the border. And that is what's caused this crisis today, not some change in NATO policy.
just to follow up, do you think it's kind of been a deliberate move over the last years to put troops in those areas to prevent as a hedge against NATO expansion to those places? And I'm thinking of South Ossetia, Abkhazia, the Ukraine, Eastern Ukraine and Crimea, maybe even Moldova or Azerbaijan. As long as troops are there, those countries might aspire to NATO membership, but it could never happen. Is that a deliberate chess move by Putin, or is it not as Machiavellian as that?
Well, it's the tragic truth is yes, and you know I want to be clear. My normative position is different. Those were illegitimate moves, but the tragic truth, and there were triggers for all those uses of military intervention, right? You know, 2008 especially was very complicated. President Saakashvili did try to move Russian peacekeepers out of an area, and they struck back. And I think, you know, that was a tragic miscalculation. 2014 was much more egregious in my view, that, you know, he was taking, exacting revenge on those that came to power in 2014. And I want to remind everybody that doesn't remember this history, we did not force President Yanukovych to leave. The United States didn't, the West didn't, the European Union didn't. We actually helped him to cut a deal with the opposition on February 22nd, 2014. I remember it very vividly. I was at the Sochi Olympics. I was there with our Deputy Secretary Bill Burns leading our delegation. He's now the head of the CIA. And it looked like we had dodged a bullet because they had negotiated this arrangement. And then just a few hours later, Yanukovych decided to flee. There was no more government there. So the Rada, elected a new president, and then they had a free and fair election after that. That's when Putin decided to go in. But leaving forces there, I think, is one of his strategies to prevent those countries from joining NATO. I do believe that.
Thanks, Bob. Next up, we have Carlin.
My name is Carlin van Houweling, and I work for a newspaper in the Netherlands, AD, it's called. And Mr. Ambassador, I wanted to ask you about the remarkable level of openness about intelligence that we've seen in the last couple of days. I wonder if you could speak about what your impression is of the strategy here, how new this is, and what the consequences could be now. The invasion that, well, we've all been talking about didn't happen. I see the Russians using that to question U.S. credibility, basically.
Right. Yeah. Thanks for the question. It's a good question. I would say two things about it. First, just again, I don't have access to secret information anymore. I haven't been in the government since 2014. But watching from the sidelines compared to 2014, two things are very striking to me. One is the quality of intelligence seems to be a lot better than it was in 2014. When I was reading that intelligence and wondering about what Putin might do, it seems like it's just qualitatively better. And that's an interesting question. Is that because of technology? You know, what's going on there that it seems like they're more informed than we were in 2013-14? But second, to your point, it's very clear that the Biden administration has taken an aggressive approach to declassifying that information. That also is new. I remember when I worked in the government, not necessarily about Ukraine, but I remember, you know, as an outsider, I spent most of my life here at Stanford, but I remember being in meetings and learning things that I thought would be useful to tell the American people about and to tell the world about. And there were so many times that our intelligence community said, well, we can't do that because that would expose the ways by which we acquired this intelligence, right? So they're very conservative with declassification. I would say when I worked in the government, we overclassified information all the time. This is different. It feels like it's very different. And I would just note, again, I don't know for sure, but I think it's important to note that the Director of National Intelligence, Avril Haines, is a former policy maker in the Obama administration. She was the Deputy National Security Advisor. And the current director of the CIA, Bill Burns, spent his entire life at the State Department. as a diplomat and as a policymaker. And maybe that means that at the top of those two organizations in our intelligence community, you have people that A, know the Biden team well, right? So they know these people really well. And therefore, if they get a request from the National Security Advisor or from the Secretary of State or from the President of the United States, probably that's who it comes from, saying, I want to declassify this information, they are going to be more willing to do that than perhaps other leaders of those institutions.
Could you speak to the potential consequence of, well, this invasion that has been mentioned, that we've even seen dates mentioned, not happening, and the credibility of U.S. intelligence?
Oh, yeah, good question. You know, the intelligence game's not a good word. The intelligence business is always making, you know, good guesses based on limited information. And there's no doubt that American intelligence has made mistakes before, as we know most tragically in 2003, in the run-up to that war, where, you know, that's a long, complicated history for another call, but and there's no doubt about the fact that it's a guessing game, and you do your best, and then policymakers have to weigh it, and then policymakers have to weigh publishing it or not. Once you publish something like that date, for instance, well, guess what? Putin can change his mind. He doesn't have to. He doesn't have to hold to that precisely to then say that the U.S. intelligence is wrong. So I don't take that particular back and forth as being that probative that the intelligence is wrong. And I, you know, from everything I hear and watch, Putin has not changed anything qualitatively to in regarding preparations for war. You know, there was something that he's pulling his troops back or not. The way I read it in the total, and I'm happy to go into details if we have time, I haven't seen any of that happening yet. It's been a slow moving train building up to some kind of military intervention or invasion. And I just don't see the brakes, you know, getting off the tracks, all those metaphors. I don't see it. But that doesn't mean that Putin has made his final decision to invade. You know, in my interactions with Putin and writing about him, he likes to have a lot of options. He likes to keep uncertainty. He thinks he's benefiting from uncertainty right now for other foreign policy objectives. Look at the mess that he's created with the Ukrainian economy, for instance, that he's achieving without having to invade. So I think both those things can be true at the same time. The buildup is moving forward, and Putin maybe, perhaps not yet, has made his final decision.
Next, we have Matthew Peterson.
This is Matt Peterson from Barron's. Do you see any evidence that Putin is responding to the economic consequences that have been put in front of him? You know, is the sanctions threat working?
Great question, and I don't have a great answer. And I just remind you that, you know, Putin is a pretty, he's a hard intelligence target, right? Because he's a former intelligence officer. So he's careful about, he would never be on a call like this with all of us, for instance. Two, he's very isolated decision maker these days. He's been in power for, you know, two decades. So he's not having regular meetings with his finance team, his economics team, or the, you know, the so-called oligarchs in the ways that he used to earlier in his career. And that means that those that want to lobby against sanctions don't have many shots, Matthew, to do that. These are all people I used to know well. I used to interact with them pretty regularly. And even back when I was ambassador, their access to the Kremlin was fading as the more hardliners, they're called siloviki, in Russian, you know, the former KGB intelligence officers, their influence was rising. And that's just been continuing over the last several years. So it's hard to answer your question. I've seen, you know, little bits and pieces from colleagues of mine still doing business in Russia. There was a quote, for instance, from, I mean, these are tea leaves, right? I want to emphasize, but that's all we got. A businessman, his name's Konstantin Remchukov, He was quoted in the New York Times a few days ago, talking about what a catastrophe war would be. That was interesting to me because I know Mr. Remchukov. He's a very wealthy business person. He owns a newspaper in Moscow, Nizavisma Gazeta, and he is very close to many, many prominent, you know, billionaire and multimillionaire individuals in Russia. And when he decided to say that on the record in a Western newspaper, that was a signal to me that is a sentiment that I think is probably a lot larger than we can see, right? It's hard to do opinion polls. It's hard to do elite polls. Nobody has an interest in talking to you, Matthew, if you know you're running Sberbank or Mr. Deripaska or all those guys. I mean, they have to be careful, right? But my sense, somebody who interacts with Russians pretty frequently, there's a lot of nervousness about what might happen and the economic consequences, because the Biden administration has communicated pretty clearly that these will be sanctions that will affect not just individuals, but probably, you know, millions of people. If Sberbank can't use dollars, for instance, that's one of the things being threatened, that's going to affect lots of Russians, not just German Gref. And one little anecdote on this, just because it reminds me of the comment about the date. There's this TV show in Russia, Vecherny Urgant is called, and it's kind of like the Stephen Colbert show for the Americans on the call here. It's late at night. He's very funny, Urgant. And he, you know, he has his sidekick. He has his monologue at the beginning, and his monologue, I think it was last night, was about this date. And he said, Vrodibly, for those who speak Russian, he says, well, I guess there's going to be war tomorrow because we were told it was the 16th. And they were kind of joking about it. And why the 16th? And he's like, well, everybody couldn't make it on the 17th. Well, they couldn't make it on the 14th, so they decided on the 16th. But then he's a very clever comedian. He said, but, you know, that's kind of getting close to, and I'm paraphrasing here, please don't quote me, but I'll send a link on Twitter if you want to see it. And then he's like, you know, that's getting pretty close to International Women's Day, March 8th. We can't have a war during March 8th. And they're like, oh, yeah, that's a really bad idea. And then he's like, oh, my goodness, I just realized something. Easter comes up right after that. Like, and his sidekick was like, yeah, that'd be bad to have a war during Easter. And then he's like, May 9th, the Great Patriotic War anniversary. Surely we can't be at war for that. And they joked about it. And at the end of the joke, he's like, why can't we just postpone this war? And then he said, how about for like 700 years? And he got a giant round of applause. And this is on a television program, their main television station that is owned and controlled by the Kremlin. And I thought that was quite a revealing little, you know, the sentiment, you know, the enthusiasm for war. I find anecdotally, but it seems very low to me in Russia today.
So next up, we have Clemens Wergen.
From Berlin with the newspaper Die Welt. I have a question regarding possible off-ramps that we can offer Mr. Putin without infringing on our own values and our ideas of how the international order should work. So you mentioned one, US rockets on Ukrainian soil that we could agree to not put them there. Are there other things that we can offer that as like face-saving offers that are not substantial to the things that we cannot give?
So it's a good question. And I see we're running out of time, so I won't go through them all, but we will. I think we may have posted in the chat my foreign affairs article where I go through in a lot of detail some other ideas that I have, but let's talk about a few of them. So one would be all of the things we used to do to enhance transparency to get back to that. So open skies, you know, CFE notifications, Vienna documents, those are things, you know, there have to be rewritten and redone, but anything that enhances transparency, that's number one. Number two, we could agree to pull back our forces. And we could do that in a verifiable way so that we don't have forces right on the borders between Russia and NATO. I think that's a fairly easy thing to do. Three, we could increase transparency about training exercises. It's hard to know the difference between a training exercise and preparation for war, but you can help to mitigate that by having observers at your different training exercises. And we've done this in the past. We could get back to that. Fourth, I can't remember what number I'm on, and your point, Clemens, about we could agree to not deploy certain kinds of weapons in threatening ways. You know, to me, offensive rockets, especially those armed with nuclear weapons, are the most destabilizing. And so I think we could agree to not deploy some of those. And if we're going to deploy them, at least deploy ones that are not nuclear armed. I still, you know, call me naive, call me idealistic, but I think we could still get back to the INF treaty, provided that Russia was willing to adhere to, you know, certain complaints that we had. It may need amendment, it may need changes, but that was a treaty that I think was really enhancing for security for all of Europe. And that would be a set of weapons that I would want to see at least limited, if not removed altogether. And I even think this is way more audacious, and this would be very controversial in my country, but I think we could agree to limits on missile defenses that don't undermine what we call euphemistically strategic stability, mutual assured destruction. In other words, I do not think it is out of the realm of the possibility that the United States would agree to not deploy missile interceptors that have capabilities against Russian warheads and Russian rockets. There's a big misunderstanding out there that I want to be crystal clear about. And I was involved in this transition from the missile systems that the Bush administration proposed for Poland and the Czech Republic versus what we proposed, the Obama administration, that is now being implemented in Romania and Poland. What we are doing in Romania and Poland are SM-3 interceptors. They're not GBIs, ground-based interceptors. They do not have capabilities against Russian rockets or Russian warheads. And I think capping that capability to be against other kinds of rockets, other kinds of threats to Europe, that could be something that we could cooperate on. And then finally, because I think it's important to underscore that there are going to be certain issues that we're going to have to live with ambiguity. Recall, we did that in the Helsinki Final Act. You know, our definitions of human rights and Soviet definitions of human rights, our definitions of free-flowing information and theirs, non-interference, they were different interpretations of the same words, but sometimes that's necessary in order to keep the peace. And I would just remind everybody, you know, we're in a more tense moment now over Taiwan, but one of the ways we've been able to keep the peace vis-a-vis China and Taiwan and the United States and our allies in Asia is that we've deliberately been ambiguous about sovereignty. We deliberately were ambiguous. One of my colleagues here at Stanford wrote a book about this phenomenon. He calls it organized hypocrisy when talking about sovereignty, because sometimes you need ambiguity as a way to keep the peace.
I would like to have your view. If you just presume for a moment, I'm not sure that's actually the case, but presume for a moment that Putin doesn't want to wage war in the next weeks. What is the most likely scenario for the coming months in that case? Some people say that Putin could still leave a significant amount of troops there to keep up the pressure and the fear of a war in order to further damage Ukraine's economy and drive a wedge in Ukrainian society and politics. Is that a scenario that you think is likely?
It's most certainly a scenario I worry about. I think there's been too much chatter, at least to hear in the American press, about, oh, he's only got a certain window and then it's going to be too expensive and he's got to pull these forces back. And that's just an American conception of how politics work. He controls the entire budget of the economy. He controls everything. Where's this budgetary pressure coming from? I mean, I'm making it more black and white, but I just think we presume and we overlay a kind of cost-benefit analysis onto Putin from our own historical political experiences that I just think are different in Russia. So I think he could keep those soldiers there for a long time. He could move them away, bring them back. And the general point of keeping pressure on Ukraine is something that I think Putin will do for the rest of his days as the Russian president. I don't think that objective will change. And, you know, the pressure on the Ukrainian economy is real. They are struggling right now, and he's achieving that objective, and it is causing tensions inside Ukraine. That is real. And if he uses force, if he invades, that will cause tensions in Ukrainian society too, because right now, President Zelensky, for very rational reasons, is trying to keep people calm. He doesn't want hundreds of people lining up at every bank in Ukraine demanding their money, and he doesn't want people fleeing the borders. But as a result of that, some of his political critics inside Ukraine are complaining that he's not doing enough to prepare for a war. And so if there is a war, those critics are going to be loud and say, you know, what was Zelensky doing? And so that is all part of Putin's agenda. You know, he wants to see this government fail. He wants Ukrainian democracy to fail so that he can say to his people in the world, you know, democracies don't work. Regimes like mine do.
Well, that's it for all the journalist questions.
We said we're going to get to a few non-journalists. Okay. Why don't you read off ones or bring them on? I'll take a list and I'll do one round of trying to answer.
Okay. Here's one. You know what? Rajib Qureshi has been very patient, and okay, I'm going to allow him to talk and ask his question.
Okay.
And then others can submit their questions via the Q&A. And I'll read a few off, and maybe okay, we can do a wrap up that way.
Thank you guys so much. I really love the opportunity to be able to ask the questions. I have two questions, if you don't mind, and you can answer it or not answer it. The first question is, Putin is an aggressor. He's been unilaterally dropping bombs in Syria, murdering countless civilians. To me, essentially, he's a terrorist, and I just don't see why it's like kind of negotiating with the terrorists. I don't see why we don't take a more hardline approach with them. And my second question is, why isn't NATO being a little bit more aggressive? I know that Ukraine is not a part of NATO, but they have sent a very, very clear signal to the world that they would like to participate in democracy. And it wouldn't be the first time we've kind of like unilaterally had NATO intervention. In Libya, we've taken actions to get rid of their dictator, and we implemented a no-fly zone, and we had NATO strikes. I was just kind of wondering why we can't be a little bit more aggressive.
Good questions.
And I'll summarize these
okay,
the best I can. Why doesn't the West make a bigger deal of LGBT rights under Putin's Russia? You know, what is the role of Russia's oil and gas sales? Why would it risk disrupting those? Is a new peace agreement as an update of Helsinki 1975 needed again? Which does Putin see as more threatening, EU or NATO membership for Ukraine, and why? And what are the long-term impacts of Putin's actions today in 10 or 15, 30 years?
Okay, great questions. And I'm now looking at the clock and I do have to go pretty quick, but I'm going to try to do some justice to them all. Rajib, on your two questions, I think it's a very important thing. I'm glad you mentioned Syria. And I think a lot of the world forgets about the horrific ways that the Russian Air Force was used to prop up that dictator. And as a result, lots of civilians were killed. It was horrific what has happened there. And we in the West stopped paying attention. And that is a victory for Putin, by the way. He feels that he was successful. This is the point I want to make. Successful in 2014 in Ukraine, successful in Syria in 2015, successful in intervening in our elections in 2016, and he got away with all those interventions with very little consequences. And I think that's, whether that's a good accurate assessment or not, I wouldn't quite agree with it, but I think that's his perception of what's going on now. And that's why he may be more risky in terms of what he's doing now. He may be willing to take these kind of risks that other people might say, well, this is irrational, this doesn't make sense. He thinks he's on a run. And with your point about negotiating with the terrorists, I actually wrote about that in the foreign affairs piece. He has completely invented this crisis, and he is now holding a gun, literally, thousands of guns, hundreds of thousands of guns, maybe, to the heads of the innocent Ukrainian people, completely unprovoked. There's no justification whatsoever for him to intervene. This phantom futuristic threat of NATO is just that. And I would just remind everybody, NATO's never attacked the Soviet Union. NATO's never attacked Russia. NATO's a defensive alliance that only creates a problem for Putin if he wants to attack a NATO member. That's the history of 70 years of NATO-Soviet, NATO-Russian history. But sometimes you're compelled to negotiate with a hostage taker. But we should do it with eyes wide open and know that it's a temporary solution. It's not going to solve the fundamental problem. Why hasn't NATO been more aggressive? I think because NATO is divided. That's why. I think the Biden administration has amazingly, in my view, assembled more unity in NATO than I would have predicted at this point in this crisis. I want to be honest about that. And they've invested just tons of time and effort to make that happen. That said, more aggressive acts, I don't think you would get consensus from, and NATO works according to consensus. For instance, there's something called the NATO Response Force that some, including me, in testimony even just today before the US Congress, said should be activated to be deployed to the frontline states of NATO. Right now, the United States is doing that in a bilateral basis, not through the NATO alliance. And when I have brought this up in the past with my friends in the government, they say that there's not enough consensus in the alliance to activate the NRF. So the question about why no more on LGBT rights, there should always be more. I'm glad you raised it. You're reminding me that when I went to the Sochi Olympics as a representative of the United States government with delegations, including gay athletes, we were making a very strong statement about LGBT rights with respect to the Olympics. And you can go back and read about it. It was very contentious. The Russians were extremely upset at the Obama administration and me personally. And we should continue to do more, because while we're all debating NATO expansion and looking at that shiny object that Putin wants us to debate, we're not talking about human rights abuses that have, I think 2021 was probably the most repressive year in Russian history since the collapse of the Soviet Union. And yet we're not focusing enough on those issues. And we should be, including in the caucuses, where some really atrocious things have been happening with respect to LGBT rights recently. Oil and gas sales, great question. And this gives maybe cause for hope, because on the one hand, people are worried that Putin might cut off oil and gas if there are economic sanctions, but everybody should remember that he relies on the revenues from selling that energy to Europe quite a bit. So this is a kind of economic interdependence that, maybe, hopefully, might get him to reconsider using military force. And in particular, he has been, his companies have been involved in building something called Nord Stream 2, a new gas pipeline to Germany. It's near completion. President Biden has made crystal clear that we will do everything in our power to shut that pipeline down if he invades. And my understanding is that we do have the power to do that through sanctioning companies, not allowing them to use the dollar for transactions. So I think there's power that we have even unilaterally there to shut that down. So hopefully he'll think twice before he does that, because that's an important thing that he, both for political and economic influence, economic revenue and political influence that he wants to finish. EU versus NATO, good question. The last crisis over Ukraine was triggered not because of NATO membership or not, but because of EU membership. And I'm glad whoever asked the question reminded everybody about that. And just to go through the details quickly, historical details, President Yanukovych was supposed to sign an accession agreement to be on the long road to join the European Union. It wasn't going to happen overnight. You know, they were talking, I think, in terms of decades, not months or years. And Putin said, you can't sign that because you need to join the Eurasian Economic Union, his kind of counter organization to the European Union. And there was a political struggle. And at the end of the day, Putin offered Yanukovych, you know, allegedly, it's hard to trace exactly this number, but $15 billion to not sign the EU agreement. And it looked like Putin had won that round. I was still the ambassador. I remember vividly meeting with Russian government officials about it. But then, and this is the part that Putin doesn't understand, and this will be a nice segue to my last answer about 10 to 15 years. But then there was this guy, his name's Mustafa Naim. I know him, he's a Ukrainian. Born, his family's from Afghanistan, but he's, you know, lived his whole life in Ukraine. He saw that Yanukovych decided not to sign that, and he was outraged. And he said, I want to be, you know, I'm European. He's double-crossed us here. And he said, you know, come join me on the square. And that's exactly what happened. First 5,000, 10,000, later hundreds of thousands of people showed up on the main square of Kyiv to protest Yanukovych's decision to not join the EU. Think about that. Like, think about what an incredible moment that was, that that was what triggered it. And that, of course, you know, that eventually led to the downfall of Yanukovych and the annexation, everything that came from that. But I think it's important to remember that in the long run, Putin is against, his greatest fear is a thriving democratic Europe that includes Ukraine. Because if a thriving democratic Europe includes Ukraine, that undermines his argument about the kind of regime that he is seeking legitimacy for in front of his own people, right? His autocracy. And that is especially troubling to him when they're Slavs, when they're people that Putin himself has just recently written a very long article where he says Ukrainians and Russians are no different from each other. Well, you can't argue on the one hand that Russia needs a strong czar and we're different and we don't think like you and we need to have this strong state. You know, that's a code word for not democracy because of our culture. And then have right next to you a country with the same culture and historical legacies, according to your own analysis, Mr. Putin, that has a functioning democracy. And to me, that is the central drama that's going on here today. It's exactly about those sets of issues. And that I'm going to close on about what down the road 10, 15, 20 years from now. One, I'm going to make a radical prediction, okay? I'm going to make a prediction that Vladimir Putin will not rule Russia forever. You know, we in political science, we're not very good at predictions. That's something I'm going to predict. I think he's going to be there for as long as he's able, but eventually there will be a new leader in Russia. And I don't believe the regime that Putin has put in place today is going to be strong enough just to continue Putinism for 20 or 30 years. The political party there is rather weak. It's based as much on coercion as a set of ideas that people get excited about. I think there will be, and I don't want to predict to claim it'll be right away. I think it'll take some time. He'll appoint a protege. But I think there will be drama in the post-Putin era about Russia's future. I don't think everybody's like, oh, this is so great. We just want to live in isolation. Some people think that, but even a public opinion poll today show that that's not true. And the younger you are, the more educated you are, And the richer you are, and the more urban you are, the more you want to be part of Europe if you're living in Russia today. The more you support democratic values as opposed to autocratic values. And those are the demographics that over time will be growing in Russia, not getting smaller. So in the long run, I think Russia is a European country. And I think eventually there will be a drama. I don't want to predict when it will be, but I do not accept the argument that everything's fixed, Russia's out of Europe, Russia will never be democratic because of, you know, some autocratic gene that they have or some history that prevents them from being that. No, in the long run, you know, if I'm betting, what's more likely? That the regime that Putin has in place today will be in place in 30 years, or that something else will replace it? In the long run, I think the former is a lot less likely than the latter. Last thing I'll say, I used to have, I'll be really quick. There's a theory in American political science called modernization theory. And it says the more well-to-do a society is, the more likely it is to become democratic. Now that theory is really bad at predicting regime transitions and democratization. It's really, really bad. It does not give you point predictions. But over the course of decades and centuries, it's pretty robust. The richest countries in the world today, GDP per capita, if you take the oil exporters out, are all democracies. The only outliers are Singapore and Hong Kong, if you still count Hong Kong as an independent country. Russia today is one of the richest countries, GDP per capita, that is still ruled by an autocratic regime. And that, to me, I think is an important thing to think about for the long term. How long will that be sustained? Maybe we're in a new moment where autocratic regimes outperform democratic regimes in terms of things that people want. But I think that question has still not been resolved, and most certainly hasn't been resolved with respect to Russia's long-term future. And with that, we better go. I'm late. Great you joined us. Ari, back over to you.
Thank you all very much for joining us. And thank you, Mike, so much for the time.